Hey there, welcome back to Polyesthetic. In this video, I'm going to show you how to create 3D particle explosion, but each particle having its own animated sprite texture. Now, this is trivial to do in 2D because it's readily built in and you can find a whole bunch of tutorials on how to do that, but not so for 3D. Now, as of this version of Godot, 3.4.2, the editor doesn't have a direct way of doing it. I think this is changing in Godot 4, but I'm not sure. But there is a quick workaround, and then there's the long way, which also allows you to randomly select an animated sprite track. So in this case, in my explosion, it selects from one of three animations, basically, animation tracks. So I'm going to assume that you already have your animated sprites ready to go. So let's start a new scene, 3D scene. And we'll change this type to particles. Now, first thing we're going to do is let's change the lifetime to 0.8 and make it the explosiveness to 1. And for our process material, we're going to add a new particle material here. And for our draw passes, we're going to add a quad mesh. There we go. And for our process material, we're going to turn off the gravity. Add some initial velocity. There we go. We're gonna make the direction spread 180 degrees. And we're gonna add some damping. Okay, so this looks okay, more or less. Now, if you wanna do this the quick way, what you do is you go to geometry, under the geometry instance section. In the material override, simply create a new spatial material. Click into the material. And under your parameters flags, set the billboard mode to particle billboard. Now they'll always face the camera. Now go back to your material and convert it into a shader material. Now here you've got a bunch of parameters. And what you'll notice is you've actually somehow gotten this particle animation horizontal and vertical frames, which don't show up otherwise. So we can take our animated sprite and, well, that was an image, so I've got to turn this into an image and feed our image into here. Here we go. And we can set the number of horizontal frames. In this case, it's 5. And vertical frames, which is 3. Now, going back to our process particle material, you can go to animation and set the animation speed just to 1. Now, what's happening is it's actually cycling through all of them, like that. So, if you have an animation that goes across and then down and it's one continuous animation, you're basically done. But if you want to select different tracks per particle, then we're gonna have to do this long way. Now there's one more thing I've gotta show you here, which if you go back to your shader, click into that shader, under the fragment function, you're also going to write to the alpha channel. So alpha. Now here we're going to take our albedo texture and just take the alpha channel. So now there the sprites are properly transparent. Now in this auto-generated texture, looks a bit opaque, but we'll go through it. These three lines of code do the billboarding, the particle billboarding. And the remainder of these actually control the particle animation. Now, from the particle shader, there is a value that is output called instance custom, which is a three-dimensional vector. The X value of this vector is the rotation of the particle. The Y value is the phase, and that's what's important to us. because the phase determines what point the particle is in its lifetime. Zero meaning it's just emitted, and one means it's just about to be removed. So zero is the beginning of its life, one is the end of its life. And the final one is Z, and this determines the animation frame based on the number of horizontal and vertical frames. And so all of this is calculated for you here, and with the UV updated and in the fragment, the texture that we fed in is red, but with this modified UV based on the current animation frame. All right, so now if we want to do this the hard way, let's clear this out and we'll start from scratch. So let's just add a new shader. Now this shader type will be spatial because it exists in three-dimensional space. And here, go to export a uniform sampler 2D. And we'll call this, well, we'll just call it text. It'll be our texture. So if we go back to our shader params, we can feed in our texture here. Now the first bit is a bit opaque, but I'll try and explain it as best as I can understand it. We'll do the billboarding first. And this is done on the vertex function. So void vertex. Now the first thing we do is we take the transform of each of these particles and we map it so that it faces the camera. And so let's create a new matrix here. We'll call it global matrix. And we'll build a new matrix here, a new mat form. And for the values, we take the camera matrix. This is a built-in. We'll pass in the first column. Camera matrix here. For the second column, so that's the Y column. So this first one here is the horizontal direction. It's the X. The second value is Y, so up and down. Now the final two values we don't care about. So the Z direction is just looking into the camera. So we'll just keep that as the world matrix, the global matrix of the object. And the fourth column is the origin, and that should definitely stay. That should stay as that of the original particle object. Now, to take this matrix and convert it into something we can see, we update the model view matrix. So that's the transform on the screen. And we take the inverse camera matrix and we multiply it by this new global matrix. Now, for most purposes, this is quite okay. However, there is one thing that we need to check. When we vary the angle now, you'll notice that the particles are no longer rotating. That's because the particles just obey the camera transform. So we need to find a way to incorporate this angle parameter into our shader. So let's go back to our shader. What we're doing here is we're updating the global matrix again. And we're going to take our matrix and we're going to multiply it by a rotation matrix about Z. Now the camera Z is going into the screen. So as the angle rotates, the particles will rotate as expected. Now to access the angle, we actually do have a built-in that comes from the particle shader. It's the same as the instance custom.x that I mentioned earlier. And we're basically going to use the Z rotation matrix here. So that's what I'm going to be doing in code here. So we'll take our global matrix and we'll multiply it by the new rotation matrix. I'm going to build it from four vectors. So the first one is the cosine of the angle, the sine of the angle, zero. And now this is a 4D vector, 4D matrix, because it also includes the origin. And so the way we handle this is we add 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, and the last one is 1. Okay, so here we go, cos. Now I'm just going to put a float theta here. Instance custom dot x, just to save a bit of typing. This is cos theta, sine theta, 0f, 0f. Our third column, 0, 0, 0. Oh, sorry, that one's 1, and then 0. And for our final one, there we go. Doesn't look like much has happened, but if we go back to our particle shader, and we increase the angle, you'll notice that they're rotating now. And remember, it's counterclockwise. Cool. Now, if you didn't understand much of that, don't worry, it's quite complicated. I barely understand it myself. And I just read into and tweaked the auto-generated shader anyway. But it makes sense. So that's the particles. Now, to make the animation, what we need is the current phase of the particle. Remember, phase goes from 0 to 1, 0 being the particle that's just been emitted, 1 means that it's about to be removed. But we don't want this in the vertex function, we want it in the fragment function. So to pass data from one function to another, we use a varying variable. So here we'll say varying float, and we'll call this phase. And remember that lifetime information comes from the instance custom. So phase is equal to instance custom dot y. Whoops. Okay, that's it for our vertex function for now. Let's go into our fragment function. Now, let's create a new vector for color. And we're going to sample the texture that we put in, which I named text. We're going to sample it at the UV of the meshes that we're instancing. And here, let's set the emission channel. Oh, we could use albedo. Let's just use albedo for now. And we'll set that to the color.rgb. So you can see our particle, our animation sheet is here. And we'll also update the alpha again. So color.alpha. Okay, that's our sheet. Now all of the fun happens in this little UV argument we're passing into the texture sampler. Now our texture here is 5 frames across and 3 frames down. So let's make a bunch of uniforms here so we can vary these dynamically. And we'll make them floats because it'll make the math operations easier. Even though integers might make more sense, it's easier to work with floats here. So we'll say horizontal frames, vertical frames. 3 of them. First thing we'll do is we'll scale the UV. So vector 2, you can say UV scalar. Now this is 1 over the x is the number of horizontal frames, and y is 1 over the vertical frames. And then we multiply this UV by the UV scalar. And now you'll see we're only emitting the first frame of our texture. So now, if we want the next frame, we'd have to offset it by 1 over the number of horizontal frames. 1 over 5, which is 0.2. So if we do this, we get the next frame, which is this one here. Let's make it 0.6, which is that frame here. So 0 takes you to the first, 0.2 the second, 0.4 the third, 0.6 the fourth, 0.8 the last one in the X. How do we step through the values like that? Now, the way we do this is we actually multiply it first by the number of frames and we perform a floor function. So here, let's define a new float. We'll call this the frame number. And so here we take the lifetime. The phase. So remember, phase goes from 0 to 1. And then we multiply this by the number of frames. Okay. So now this value varies from 0 to 5. But it varies as a float, so they're fractional parts. What we want is to floor this function. So it'll go from 0 and then to, once it hits 0.2, goes to 1, then 2, 3, and 4. So I'll take this, pass it into a floor operation. Then we divide this by the number of horizontal frames. Oops. This is horizontal frames. Okay. So the phase varies from 0 to 1. Multiply this by the number of phases. It will vary from 0 to 5. And then floor it. So it'll be an integer. 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Then divide it by the number of horizontal frames. So then we get 0, 0.2, 0.4, 0.6, 0.8. That's it. We can now call our shifted UV, or UV shifter. Here we can take our frame number, and for now we'll pass 0 into the Y coordinates. So take our scaled UV and add on our UV shifter. Now you'll see we're correctly cycling through the animation frames. Now we do something similar to move up and down the frames. So 0 takes us to the first animation track. 0.333 onwards to the second one, and 0.66 repeated shows us our third animation track. But how do we select this track? Now you can select this randomly using some random number generator and then taking the modulo of the number of tracks. So in this case, we've got 3 tracks. So if you take the modulo of 3 with some random number, you're getting either 0, 1, or 2, which you can then use to shift the UV coordinate. But what I'm going to do instead is use another inbuilt value. First, I'm going to take another variable. I'm going to call this track. So this is track 1, 2, and 3. And I'm going to assign the track. Here, we've got something called the instance ID. And so I believe this is in sequential order. Every time a particle is emitted, it's given an ID, and then the next one is given, it's given the next ID. So it's incremented by 1 each time. So if we take this integer and take the modulo of the number of vertical frames, which is equal to the number of animation tracks we have. Now this is a float, so we need to cast it to an integer. And then we take this whole thing and we cast it back into a float. So this will actually cycle through the tracks evenly because it's increment. So it'll go from 0, 1, 2, and then 0, 1, 2 again, and so on. And so we can, back in our fragment function, we can create a new float called the track number. You can take our current track, and this needs to be fractional. So rather than 0.12, we want it to be 0.333 and 0.666. So we just divide it by the number of vertical frames. And so in our UV shifter, we pass in the track number. And there you go. We've now got each of the three animation tracks in there, and they're all animated. Now, albedo looks a little dull, so I'm going to change this to emission. And I'm going to change the albedo to black. And there you have it. Perfectly replicated. Now, of course, you can assign random rotation to this and all sorts of other flavors you want to add yourself. So here, for example, to make it look like an explosion and make it very bright, I'm going to change the render mode. To add. Okay, so here's a completed shader. Thank you for watching. Hopefully you took something away from that. If you have any questions, comments, suggestions, please put them in that little box down below. Make sure to hit like and subscribe if you like this video, and I'll see you in the next one. Thank you.